Welcome back to the workshop. In the first video we saw an introduction to the transfer box overhaul. I decided that I'm going to start by replacing the bush in the front output shaft. This is exactly the same part as in the end of the crankshaft for the primary pinion on the gearbox. It's particularly important with the crankshaft that you soak this bush in oil, boil it in oil if you can for a little while so that it soaks some up. It's a sintered bush. I just leave them sitting in a jar of oil for a week usually. This one I've just wiped and cleaned it up, but it feels nice and oily. It will just help it in this case when we first hit the road. In the case of the crank spigot, it's quite important for the life of the bearing. So with the crank spigot, you could take this out by filling up that void in there with grease and then driving a tight fitting piston of some description in there, maybe a piece of ground bar stock, in to force the bush out. But there's actually an oil hole drilled in the side of this, so you can't do that. Fortunately, the shaft is pretty hard, and what you can do is get a slotting saw or a hacksaw blade and just cut through it. So that's what I'm going to do in this case. When fitted, this bush will need to be reamed to size. Obviously there's no point in doing that before you fit it. And the old bush all extracted. Hopefully you can see no harm done to the interior of the front output shaft. Just cleaned up the inside a bit with emery paper and brake cleaner, and now I'm going to drive that bush in there. Now we come to fitting the bush. I'm going to heat up the shaft with my hot air gun. It doesn't need to be ridiculous, but just to warm it up a bit, it will help just to expand that bore. We've cleaned that out reasonably well. A couple of things I've done here. I've just rather roughly turned a slight chamfer on the end of that bush, which will just help it. It'll just give it a start on the way in. You could use an old output shaft, rear output shaft, to drive the bush in. I'm going to use an old primary pinion. This one's off an old 2A, just simply because it's a bit shorter and this is knackered. I'm never going to use that again. The bush will probably get stuck on there, but we will be able to get that out. Been there, done that before. I'm not too worried about it. What I have done is I've just turned the washer, because if you use either the output shaft, which you'll certainly have if you're doing this job, or an input shaft, there's a radius on there which will ultimately damage the bush. So you could file out a washer to fit that if you haven't got a lathe. And then it should make it fairly easy to drive it in. The other end, to use it as a drift, I'm then just going to drop a socket in there. Give me something to hit with the copper hammer. Thank you. So we're nearly there, flush with the end of the shaft. It actually needs to go a little further, though the position isn't terribly critical. But as you can see at the moment, if this shaft is as close as that, it'll be riding the radius. The bushes as installed tend to be about 1 to 1.5 millimeters below the edge of this surface. The position of the bush, as I say, is not that critical, provided it isn't covering the oil hole. This shaft is retained by a bearing either end, so this shaft should not be floating towards this one, and this one is retained at the front end, so we just need to find a way of driving that a little further in now. Obviously a press would be far better for this if you've got one. I have access to a press, I could do all this the easy way, but the point is most people won't, and there are non-damaging ways of pressing bearings in with hammers and drifts and things. It's not so nice, but let me just tilt the camera down a bit. In this case you can see I've got these wooden blocks here which this shaft butts up to, preventing the nose of the front output shaft from striking the vise. So this is quite safe. And as hopefully you'll be able to see, we haven't burred up the end of that bush. So it can be done. So that's the bush pressed further into the shaft, about 1/8 of an inch, which is about right. I couldn't find a measurement for that in the book, but basically, as I described, it just needs to allow the rear output shaft right up to the front output shaft, which in reality won't happen, because as I said, the bearings hold it something like that. You can see the line where the bush has been running, so there's again about 1/8 of an inch gap. But it means there's no foul up with the bush there. I think we'll actually need to ream this. I'll measure it and just find out. But certainly the last one of these I did, I had to ream the bush, and there was no way it was all going to fit together, so that's somewhat easier this time. Well, the thought has just occurred to me, of course, that we should leave this to cool down before we measure it, which would be a sensible thing to do. But for the meantime, I'm just going to scrape the inevitable high spot that we've created. A bit of side play there, but rather better than the old one. Right, so it's all cooled down nicely now. I've got the new rear output shaft out, which fits beautifully, and we'll just measure it. The workshop handbook states that the bush should be 876 thousandths inside diameter. 7/8 is 875, so it's basically 7/8 and a thou clearance. Which is exactly what the new bush measures up. Anyway, spot on. Well, I think this is going to be about it for today. A gentle start to the job, but this oil thrower here should be an inch plus or minus a 32nd of an inch measured from this shoulder, and this one's just over inch eighth, so it's probably not massively critical, but it ought to be in the right place. So couple of 2BA spanners and we'll shift it to where it ought to be. I think it's just so that it feeds oil onto the selector shaft mechanism. And that one's loose anyway. Look. Amazing how much gunge can hide in something like that. Anyway, the selector shafts were seized up on this box, so maybe that was the reason. Who knows? That's an inch. Well, hello and welcome back to the workshop. Just a quick update before we start. The gearbox assembly, all the castings have now been degreased. Quite a bit of work to do yet. The sealing faces and so on all need a proper clean up. The hole that's been bashed in the bit where the clutch slave goes, presumably someone had trouble with the probably some Remy mechanic had trouble with the clutch at some time and knocked a hole in it to put the pushrod back on. And there's a few bits to clean up on the gasket faces and where bearings go, but you know, an afternoon's fettling with a file, we'll sort that out. A few more bits have come back from powder coat now. The lay shaft and primary pinion bearing cover. You can see that the lay shaft bolt had come loose, which was causing considerable noise. Got a new clutch fork pivot to go in there as well, so we'll press that in. On that subject, I've ordered a press actually. I've struggled on for years and years without a press at home and decided it was finally time. So hopefully we'll do the rest with a press. That's the breather from the top of the gearbox. That was all clogged with mud, so we've dealt with that. Operating rod for the four-wheel drive in high range, so that's the yellow knob. And cover for the transfer box, that's a Roma drive one, so aftermarket with filler. And then another gearbox cover plate. These are supposed to have these horrible little plastic breather cap things. I might make some brass ones, a bit like axle breathers, which will be a bit nicer. I've also bought an old spring balance on eBay. This is an 8-pound Salter spring balance, and from memory the output shaft gets a preload of 2 to 4 pounds, so right in the middle of the scale, which is where you want. It's no good buying a scale that reads up to the maximum figure you're looking for. So I'll just hang some weights on that of a known value and we'll just see that it reads somewhere about right. Anyway, we'll come to what to do with that at a later date. Today we're going to carry on with the transfer box and particularly the front output shaft assembly, since we started there. It makes sense to carry on. We can actually assemble the selector rods into the front output shaft housing, and then that's a completed assembly ready to fit. So I was asked in the comments last time what I'd use for metal blacking. A few people asked, and this is the kit that I use from frost restoration equipment. It's really good. You'll use it time and time again, but it is quite expensive. But it's one of those things, it's worth having, I think. I'll show the process in a future video when we get to the appropriate point in the rebuild. I've got all the gearbox bits to do yet. The key with this is to clean up the parts properly first. So I'm just laying out all the bits for the front output assembly build. Someone asked me if I'd list all the part numbers. Well, yeah, a lot of them will be the same for most transfer boxes, but it's the gearboxes where we're going to come across some differences. But yeah, I'll list all the bits I've used, and you'll have to bear in mind that there will be some variation between different versions of these gearboxes. Interestingly, some of the parts in this kit do have genuine parts numbers. So these are probably the bits that Land Rover will supply you in a very expensive box. I wouldn't like to say for sure, but I suspect that's the case. If you search part numbers with a G, you'll get genuine quality parts in most cases for a lot less money than Land Rover will supply them. Japanese bearings, so I'm quite happy with the quality of those. And just for comparison, that's an aftermarket part, no G after the number. Not all Britpart components are bad. I've had a lot of good gearbox bits from them for the last build, which is still going strong. And it's generally things like that that cost a few quid are okay. It's when you're buying, you know, 45p wheel cylinders, that's when you might want to think again. It's all relative, really. Okay, so all the parts for the front output shaft assembly are laid out. The selector forks have already been apart for cleaning. There's not really much to these, so I haven't shown it on film. It's just a case of when you put it all back together, properly split pinning the nuts. And I've given the selector shafts a good polish to try and make sure that they work properly. They almost always corrode at the ends where they poke through into this tin cover, which almost always rots out. So if you're having selection issues, usually it's the front end of the selector rods. Sometimes you can clean them up without actually taking the transfer case out, just removing that cover. A couple of things to check with this, really just the diameters, but it's not terrifically important, but obviously if they are really badly worn, you might want to think about replacing them. You can see some wear there, it's not going to stop it working. The selector detents are more important. If there's big chunks missing, then yeah, you know, you want to think about replacing that, because it will pop out of gear, or it may do, but this one's okay, we can use it. I've taken these little blocks off. It's just a case of properly split pinning when you put it all back together, making sure that the four-wheel drive selector fork can move nicely. You can check the free link for these springs as well. There's also this spring here for the high-low selector shaft, and that should measure 181.76 mm, which we can see it's just about 180 mm, which for an old worn spring is pretty good. So we'll use that again. If it was half an inch shorter, maybe I'd think about replacing it. The shorter ones on the four-wheel drive selector, there's a figure given for those as well, and that's 69.8 mm. But taking those apart really needs no explanation. This selector fork here, part of the selector assembly, I haven't dismantled this, I've just re-split pinned it, as it wasn't very nice. Again, just a case of cleaning this up and making sure that it will move freely in the housing, and checking that the fixings are tight. So in the last video, okay, so the case obviously has been given a really thorough clean. I'm going to put the front output shaft bearing in there. It's supported at the front by a ball bearing, and then at the rear by the end of the main shaft and this bronze bush which we fitted previously. As I've said, I've bought a press, so going forward I'm going to be using a press for this kind of thing. But we're just going to warm up this housing with the hot air gun. And I've then got this device which I made for lapping the tops of SU carburetor float chambers, of all things, which often get warped. And we can then drive the bearing in by the outer race with a hammer, so we're not impacting the running track of the bearing.
While that's sitting there warming up nicely, it's probably just worth checking at this stage that the bearing actually fits nicely onto the shaft. If there's any horrible burrs on that, once you've got it in there, it'll be stuck. I've also packed a bit of grease into the bearing, not like a wheel bearing, but just to give it a bit of lubrication when we first run the gearbox. I say this because it's very likely that this gearbox, when it's done, and transfer box, will sit around for the next maybe 6 months, a year. So just helps protect it all as well.
If it's going to be nice to me, the bearing might just drop in, but it doesn't usually happen. That's it, we'll just leave it to cool off. Well, while the housing's cooling down, I'm just going to fit the seal for the front output shaft. This seal is actually the same part number, FRC 1780, as used in the rear output, so you can't mix them up. And it goes in this nice little aluminium housing. To fit this, you could, as a press tool, you could actually use this part of the output shaft assembly, which is a nice diameter to suit pressing in the seal. Now I'm actually going to use a large socket just because I've got one, and the arbor press, you could probably do this bit in a vise if you really needed to. I've just smeared the inside of the housing with grease. I used to use sealant on these things at one time, but it generally is unnecessary. I'll try and seat that in there as square as possible. Give it half a chance. And that's gone quite nicely actually. Now I'm just going to press the mud shield back on, which has been powder coated, so it might be interesting. But it's all fairly lightweight stuff. Yeah, and that's down square as well. That looks quite nice. Good. Obviously there is a gasket to go on the back of that, and we will use sealant with that. Haven't mentioned sealants yet. I use Wheel Seal or Heldite. I used also Universal Blue on the last one, which has been very good. It's very much leak free. Okay, so I'm just fitting the studs into the casing now. The way to do this is to lock a couple of nuts together and then just nip them up. The only reason I'm doing that is that one day I'll have to change that front seal, and it'd be really annoying if I'm doing that in situ and the studs come out, because it's quite tight to access the seal unit when it's all fitted. So I'm now going to fit the front seal unit onto the transfer box, the front output housing. The bearing in there is actually retained by this, so if that is not fully home, then the bearing housing will let you know. When you fit that, you will see a gap probably if it's not fully home. So that's quite handy. These gaskets that are supplied in the cheap gasket kits, I think the kit costs all of about £3. They're okay. They're not perfect, but they do just about fit. Generally speaking, all the gaskets are like that. I have in the past used these as templates to make my own. If I want to get something apart again, I tend to use this stuff, Stag Whale Seal, which is a fantastic product, and tend to just smear it all over the gasket. If I don't want to get something apart again, and hope it never ever leaks, and it's not a service item like a filter unit or something, then I'll use something called Heldite, which is a really excellent sealant, fuel and oil proof and so on. Probably superior to Whale Seal, but as I say, you'll struggle to get things apart that you've used that on. I feel that going tacky already, so we'll get that in place. In fact, I'm going to fit that to the seal unit itself, I think. You're less likely to damage it that way. Yeah, it is going tacky now. Anyway, I say that because there's this step it's got to fit over here. No particular way up for this to go, it just drops on. And that's right down. The only thing about Whale Seal is it is fantastically messy stuff. It does get everywhere. I had a tube of it explode on a shelf during the summer, and I had to replace the shelf. So we're now going to look at assembling the selector shafts. Important to note with this unit here, if you take it apart, when you do this bit, leave that nut loose and you can set it later on and you'll see why. Also note that the ends of that fork, the fork ends are not the same, but I'll show you the alignment of those shortly. Selector shaft's just been greased and there's a little pivot there which is important. Make sure that's tight and split pinned. And to assemble this, if you arrange your fork in that sort of alignment, you can then just slide that pivot in there. And it leaves the fork with the square end free for the other selector rod. After that, we can fit the spring. There's then this little top hat steel bush, which goes in the other end of the spring. And then a steel spacer, which goes on like so. And that's one half assembled. So assembling the other selector rod to this is very simple. It's literally just a case of slotting that into the other of those forks. And then you can see something of how they interact. There's also this pin here for the high range four-wheel drive lock, which drops through there. But obviously we fit that later on. It's fairly easy to see now why people often have trouble with these levers seizing up. This tin cover fits over the front of these, obviously at a different angle. When that's filled up with mud and rainwater and eventually rusts and so on, so do these shafts, and where they pass through the front of the housing, they seize up. So it's important to use four-wheel drive and operate the low range lever fairly often, and I tend to do that once the gearbox is hot and oil's got around, and it just keeps everything lubricated. Something I tend to do probably once a month driving the vehicle if I'm not using it off-road. You can also see that the selector lever is sprung, so if you've got issues with the springs you may not get proper selection. Otherwise it's a very simple thing, and we're now going to assemble that into the housing. So for the avoidance of doubt, as they say, this is more or less the correct orientation that the selectors will sit in. I think I had it upside down on the bench, but assembled correctly nonetheless. So you can see the detent pips facing upwards as they should be, selector fork hanging down, the four-wheel drive pin drops through the middle here, so that's a more correct orientation. We're going to carry on and assemble the shaft and then these into the housing. Make sure that's fully home, which it is, as we know it's a nice sliding fit in that bearing. We can now assemble the selector forks into the housing. It'll be a little bit difficult to show you, but basically keeping them in the orientation I just showed you, i.e. upright, I'm going to pass them into the housing. Plenty of grease as well. Now if you've loosened the nut on the connecting shaft, then it's important to put these in and then lock that nut before going ahead and fitting the four-wheel drive dog. you have loosened that nut, when you've got to this stage of having all three shafts through the casing, before you fit the coupling or drive dog, you want to drop the four-wheel drive locking pin through the hole. I think as it happens, that selector shaft is in just the right place by chance, and that has now locked that in the correct orientation, and you can then nip up the lock nut. So as it happens, we can now fit the, if it's going to stay upright, we can fit the four-wheel drive coupling. The grease, of course, will dissolve into the oil once we get driving. I just prefer it that way, to know it's got plenty of lubrication before we start, and that nothing will rust over winter. So at this stage, it's now necessary just to pull the selectors out. If you had to push them right in to tighten that nut, pull both selectors out just enough that you can then slip the coupling in there. That's it. Now at this stage we've got a couple of O-rings to fit, which come as part of the transfer box overhaul kit. And the first one is this larger O-ring, which is going to fit in that recess around the main selector shaft. This is the one that the red lever attaches to. And then there's this tiny little one. And that goes in this hole here for the four-wheel drive locking pin. So I think what I'm going to do is put that on the locking pin and then drop that in there. Be easier that way. The manual says here to use a sealant called Bostik 772 on this dust cover. I've painted the inside of mine with a crankcase sealant just to stop it rusting, because they are famous for it. Almost everyone you look at is rusted out. Anyway, it should protect it. There's no gasket for these as such, so the sealant goes on this face. I'm going to use my favourite Heldite. This, which is fantastic stuff, which hopefully will do the job, and you can lay it on quite thick. I'll probably lay on a coat of it, let it dry, and do another one. Like the wheel seal, messy old stuff, but does a good job. Just about one more thing we can do today, which is to fit the lever that operates the four-wheel drive lock. I've already replaced the bush that goes in the middle of this. It was almost worn right through. There we are, that's one complete front output shaft assembly, ready to fit to the rest of the transfer box. So the next time we're going to have a look at fitting the main shaft, or the rear output shaft rather, and its bearings. Hopefully the hydraulic press will have arrived by then, and I can show you the proper way to do it. Hope you've enjoyed the video, and thank you very much for watching.